Good morning, everybody. Happy New Year. Happy New Year. Yes, God is faithful. Another year under our belts. I'm going to invite you to open to 1 Timothy chapter 1. We'll be starting in verse 12. I grew up playing a lot of sports. I had the privilege of actually being on a lot of teams, a lot of good teams. But there's one common thing that always happened on, you can tell the difference between good teams and the not so good teams that I was on. And you can tell even the difference between the good teams and the not so good teams in the professional realm and the college realm. And one of those things that you can tell is when the season starts, how you start the season. So the good teams, they always go back to the basics. They always go back to the fundamentals. When you go out, I played basketball. I love basketball. When I was in Pee Wee, we were learning how to dribble, do layups, chest pass, bounce pass. We would learn that, and then as I got older and the competition got stiffer and teams got better, you would obviously advance your skill. You would start shooting from farther away, or you would start to do behind the back dribbles or through the legs. But on every team that had a good coach that I had on, the first thing that we would do in that first week of practice is we would do dribbling drills, and we would do passing drills, and we would do form shooting, and we would go back to the basics. We see this in professional sports as well. We see this. Spring training is a time where these professional athletes, they get paid millions of dollars to play a game. They have to sprint out to first base. They have to learn how to throw from the pitcher's mound to first base to pick off a guy. Unless you're John Lester, probably. It's a little Cubs joke. But you go back to the fundamentals. That's what the beginning of the season always starts with. It starts with the fundamentals. So what we're going to do today is we're going to go back to the fundamentals. If you are a Christian today, you've probably heard this. We're going to go through the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you're not a Christian today, consider this maybe the first time that you've heard it, or I pray that this is the first time that it sinks into your heart what we need, what the fundamentals, what the foundation of our faith really is. So 1 Timothy 1, starting in verse 12. This is Paul writing to Timothy. I thank him who has given me strength, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he has judged me faithful, appointing me to his service. Though formerly I was a blasphemer, a persecutor, and an insolent opponent, but I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But I receive mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who were to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. So this is a passage that speaks of the fundamentals of our faith, and I'm going to go through three points. The first being, we separated from God. Verse 13 says, though I formerly was a blasphemer, persecutor, and insolent opponent. This is Paul talking. As we went through the book of Acts, we saw Paul's journey. We saw him go from a persecutor of the church to someone who had saving faith through his experience on the road to Damascus. But Paul was a sinner. Paul, even though he had all the accolades in the Hebrew faith, he was a sinner. And he needed saving. We are all sinners. in need of saving. Isaiah 59, verse 2 says, "But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear." We've been separated. We've been separated. What does this separation look like? What does this mean? God is holy. He is perfect, without fault, without sin. And we are not holy. We have sinned. And even if it's one sin in your life, that creates this great chasm between you and a holy God. But we all know that it's not just one sin. We have sinned many times. Galatians 5:19 through 21 says, "Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries." Does this sound like any of our hearts? "Dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the likes of these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of heaven." Those are the sins. That's not even an exhaustive list of sins. Those are the sins that we have committed. But in Galatians, it also says that we are now to live by the Spirit, just a few verses later. Joy, peace, patience, kindness. But we have sinned. We have sinned. And it's only right that our sin be punished. Why is it right? How many of us, if, God forbid, a family member or someone that we knew was murdered, that would be a sin again? That would be a sin. We would all agree with that, right? Would it be okay for that murderer to just walk free because he might have started doing good things after that? Should we not judge him for the crime that he committed? That wouldn't be justice. So we have committed a crime against Jesus and against God. That is sin. So we deserve to be punished from that. You can't do anything to earn that back by your own. You can't give a life. You can't do anything to continue on that illustration. The giving of life does not negate the taking of a life. We cannot do anything to earn back the favor by going to a community group or doing any of the things that we need to do or we think we need to do for God. God has commanded us to do things, and his scripture has commanded us to do things. And I know in our ears, especially in the city of Chicago, especially in the 21st century, now the year 2023, when we hear that word command, I know some of us kind of shrink back. I'm an individualist. I don't take commands from anybody. So why should I listen to God? Why should I take commands from anybody? I don't even listen to my boss. I don't even listen to my wife. I'm my own man. I want us to separate our culture from what God has called us to do. Let us not project words that we hear in our culture. Let us not project the things of our culture onto God, because he is worthy of hearing our commands. There's a few examples of this that I want to go over, and with the probably my wife will be mad at me. But one of these words, what do we think when we hear the word moist? Some of us cringe. They're like, "Oh, moist. I don't like that." That's not a perfect example. I just thought that would be a funny anecdote. But when we hear the word liberal, we have immediate group of people that we think of. When we hear the word conservative, we have an immediate group of people that we think of. Those of you that follow maybe church people on Instagram or Christians on Instagram, you hear the word deconstruction, and you have an immediate grouping of people in your head. So let us not, when we hear the Lord commands us to do something, let us not project our culture onto that. God is commanding us to do stuff because he loves us. Deuteronomy 6, verse 24 and 25 says, "And the Lord commanded us to do all of these statutes, to fear the Lord our God, for our good always, that he might preserve us alive as we are this day. And it will be righteousness for us if we are carefully to do all this commandment before the Lord our God, as he has commanded us." The commandments of God are not to restrict us from life, but they are to give us life abundantly. The commandments of God are not to restrict us from life, but to give us life and life in abundance. So, we are sinners, but there is hope. I've been actually meditating on this verse in Romans 5, 2 through 6, a lot lately. I don't know about most of you, but the weight of this world has started to weigh on my shoulders. The weight of pain even in this room, in our city. I even had to stop looking at the news for a while because I was like, "Steph, this is not doing good for me." The weight of hopelessness, the weight of crime and sickness, loss of jobs, financial struggles. It's a heavy weight. And what the enemy is trying to do, I'm convinced of this, is to make us think that there is no hope. All hope is gone. You should be hopeless. And as I was feeling that for months, I was led to Romans 5, starting in verse 2. "Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God." We can say amen to that. "Not only that, but we rejoice in our suffering." So let's pause here. I love how Paul uses progressions in his epistles. He uses these progressions, and he's going to start a progression, and it's going to seem like there is no hope. And he's going to progress through these things, and we're going to feel the weight of these things, because when we say these words, we also will think of the things in our life that we are enduring. So Paul is going to do this progression. "So, but we rejoice in our sufferings." That doesn't make any sense. Why would we rejoice in our sufferings? Continuing, "knowing that suffering produces endurance." So suffering produces endurance. "And endurance produces character. And character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. And that while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly." So how do we get from suffering to hope? What are you suffering through right now? Is it the loss of a loved one? The season is hard for many people who have lost loved ones in the last year or 5 years or 10 years, especially if it's around the holidays. Are you suffering in friendships? Are you suffering in your family, in familial relationships? Suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope will never put us to shame. I also have been in Psalm 130. I wait for the Lord, starting in verse 4. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen in the morning, more than watchmen in the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption. And he will redeem Israel from all its iniquities. There is hope, and it will not put us to shame. And good for us, we know what that hope is. Point number two, we are saved by God. We separated from God, and we are saved by God. Jumping back to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 14, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, who I am the foremost. I love this passage because Paul did so much for the church. He did so much for the early church, planting churches, training up pastors. This is literally a letter of him training up and doing more training for Timothy. But he remembers who he was before Christ. And I feel like when you read this, and if you're being honest with yourself, you're like, Paul, no. I am the worst. I am the foremost of the sinners. I'm going to draw something up here. My fancy board. I want this to be something that helps us and that we can take and that we can even share with people. Because the whole point of this message, the whole point of the gospel message, is that once we receive it, it's something that we go out and we share, and we go out and we give. So you're going to see my fantastic art skills here. Can anyone tell me what that is? A mountain, see? Fantastic. All right, so God is here. And we are here. So this is how, sorry for you guys if you can't see it on the side, but this is how every other religion in the world views that they can get to their heaven or nirvana or whatever. Every other religion in the world is, okay, I'm a nice person. I fed somebody who's homeless. I clothed somebody who's homeless. So the guy's walking up the mountain, he's doing, and the main goal is for him to get to God. So you do a good thing, climb up the mountain. So let's just say this is Mount Everest. That Mount Everest, while being the tallest mountain on Earth, it's not unattainable to get to the summit, right? There have been people that have made it to the summit. There's also been a lot of people who have died, and a lot of people like me who will never try. I swore off exercise after the marathon. I'm just not doing it. So there have been people that have attained it, right? But this actually isn't a correct depiction for many reasons, because we can never earn our way to God. So this is the actual description of what it means, right? So this is Mount Everest. So this is Mount, I don't know, something else that's way bigger. Here's the ozone layer. So this is in outer space. Oh, I forgot, sorry. There's the mountain. It's chilly up there. Let's give them two. There you go. So this is God, right? And this is us. So what the Christian faith says that no other faith says is that God knew that we couldn't climb up that mountain because it's in the ozone. So God came down to us. And there's nothing that we could do to climb up. So God said, you know what? I love them so much For while they were still weak, we are weak, church family. At the right time, God died for the ungodly. So he came down, he put us on his back, and he gave us the opportunity to come up with him. Praise God. So what does that mean? I told you we were going to go back to the fundamentals, right? I'm pretty sure all of us know this verse, even if this is your first time in church. I actually saw it yesterday, John 3:16 at one of the college games. But let's not rush through it like we all, hey, do you know John 3:16? Yeah. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that I believe in him, will not perish and have everlasting life. That's how we say it, right? Because we all know it. Let's go back to the basics. Let's actually think about this verse right now. For God so loved the world, he loved each and every one of us so much that he gave his only Son, that all you have to do is believe in him and you shall not perish, but you have the eternal life. Wow. I'm looking out here, and I shared this at Christmas, so if you were here during Christmas, you're going to hear it again. But I look out here, and I see my son. I believe he's sleeping. That's how good I am. I look at him, and I wouldn't give up anything in the world for him. No amount of money, no amount of status, no amount of power, no amount of anything. I wouldn't give up anything for my son. But the God of the universe, the only one that was holy and perfect and had the right to not be judged, sent his only Son so that we can live with him eternally. How is that not the craziest thing that we've ever heard? How is that not something that drives us with our friends that don't know Christ? How is that not something that we wake up in the morning and we're like, God, why? But thank you. How is that not something that when we're singing, when we're rejoicing, that's not the forefront of our mind? Let us not forget the fundamentals and the wildness that God would send his only Son to be killed by his creation that turned away from him because they did not want to listen to his commands. Okay, I hope I don't hit anything back here. I might move this up a little bit. I actually have a... We talk about this often. I know Jeff mentions it a lot. This should look familiar to most of us if it stays up. So this is what, if this is your first time here or you're new, this is what we have usually in our lobby or on the stairs, on the landing on the stairs. And I think it'll fall, but we all see it, right? Okay. This is the prayer list. It says, who can we pray for that does not know Jesus? And we kind of had the leadership team kind of had this idea like, hey, this would be great. We can pray for them. I didn't expect it to be this full. And if you look at this list, it's full of a bunch of names that most of us, if not all of us, walk past every single week. That's a very, very sad list, isn't it? If every single person on this list were to die today, they would spend eternity in hell, separated from a God who loves them so much. This is a very, very sad list. So as we get into this new year, like, you don't have to sit here and name every single person. When you walk past this list, pick one or two people, pray for them. If you wrote a name on this list, reach out to them. Share the love of Christ with them. Do life with them. Show them what's different about you than the rest of the world. Because if they died today, they would spend eternity in hell. And you wrote their names on this list because you love them and you care about them. What better love, what greater care can we have as a church, as a family, as co-laborers with Christ who have the eternal God on our side to go and share his love with them? I want to challenge us this year. Let's invite people into our homes. Let's share God's love with them. We all live in either an apartment building, or we go to a job, or we talk to 100,000 people. We see 1,000 people a week. How many of us are living out the love of Christ in our life? We are saved by God, so let us go forth and proclaim that goodness, that gospel, that God came down that mountain in the form of Jesus, lived a perfect life, died on the cross for our sins, and rose again on the third day, defeating death. He conquered death. Let us never walk past a list like this. Let us never walk past a person that we know and care about that doesn't know Jesus and not be praying for them, but also praying that God moves in our hearts, gives us the words to share with them his love and his grace. We separated from God, we are saved by God. Praise God. Praise God. 1 Timothy 1, 16 and 17. But I received mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost sinner, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who are to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Church, praise God. If you know Jesus, praise God. Amen. I think this is going to kind of be a tradition because I preached last, I think it was the second last year, but I read this exact same passage, and I think it's just a great way to start off the new year. So Lord willing, if I'm here on the first, second, third, fourth, whatever it is next year, we'll read this again. Revelation 21, verses 1 through 9. And after I read this, I think that it would be right to praise God. Give him a shout of praise. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard with a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give from the springs of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have his heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for the murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death." Praise God. There will be all things new. No more pain, no more sorrow, no more thirst, no more hunger. So in light of that truth, that is truth from the Word of God, in light of that truth, let's live with the right perspective. Let's have an eternal mindset. There are things in this world that will weigh us down. There are things in this world that will bring us to maybe a sense of hopelessness. But our time here is this short, and eternity is forever. Let's have hope in this eternal mindset in what God has done for us. So if you are here and this message is the first time that God has opened your heart to his truth, we're going to have people up here praying after the service. Just come on down. We'd love to talk to you. We'd love to share more. We'd love to pray with you. We'd love to hug you. We'd love to weep with you, tears of joy. And if you came in here today with that free gift that God has given us, if you came in here today with your eternity secure because of your faith in Jesus, who are you going to go share that gift with? Who's that person in your building, in your workplace, in your family, that you are going to share the greatest news that has ever been told? The hope of the world. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are a good, 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 good Father. That while we were sinners, while we were running as fast as we could in the other direction, you chased us. You came down that insurmountable mountain. You placed us on your back. You wiped away our tears. You bandaged our wounds. And you gave us the greatest gift of all, your Son Jesus, who died for all of those sins. And you don't see them anymore. Lord, let us live with an eternal mindset. Let us be on mission. Lord, you have commissioned us, all of those who believe, to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And Lord, you did not leave us that mission alone. You left us that mission. And you said, "And I will be with you always, to the end of the age." Lord, we give you thanks for your word. We give you thanks for allowing us to gather. Lord, allow our hearts to be shaped by the greatest news in all of the world. In Jesus' name we pray.